Good morning, Oasis. I've got some exciting news for you. I want you to get out your calendars and I want you to mark Sunday, October the 4th. It's just a few weeks from now, and on that day, we are going to regather for worship at the church. Hey! It's been a long time, and I've been really looking forward to it, and I'm so excited about it, I just wanted to let you know. We have been working on some safety measures, and we have a few more things to put into place, and we're also working on kind of improving our capacity to broadcast the service live. So we will be doing that. So if you're not able to attend in person, you'll still be able to attend with us kind of virtually the way we have been doing it. So I'm looking forward to it, but for now, let's just continue to worship the Lord this Sunday morning.
Good morning, Oasis. We cannot wait to worship with you in person on October 4th. We're so excited about doing that together. We're going to let you know some more about what that looks like. But for right now, we're going to worship together in our homes. Go ahead and grab your elements of communion. We're going to worship Jesus together. Would you receive this praise, God? We ask in Jesus' name. Good morning, Oasis. Our call to worship is from one of my favorite Psalms, 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his way to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Let us pray. God of freedom, you brought your people out of slavery with a mighty hand. Deliver us from our captivity to pride and indifference to the need and gifts of others, that we may be ready to love as you have loved us and give even as we have received. Amen.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every his covenant, his blood, support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground.
All other ground is sinking sand. God, we place our faith in you.
firmly in your hand. And on your name, we bear your name, and we ask that you would allow us to root our faith and let us be grounded in you. So that when the winds come and the storms blow as they are now, we'd be rooted and grounded in your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, Oasis. It's time for Grace and Peace. So if you have a phone, pull it out, text somebody, call somebody. If you're watching this on YouTube, you can scroll down to the message part and text in there. And if you want to make a video like this, you can record a short video saying Grace and Peace to Oasis Church and send that to info@oasischurch.org. That's info@oasischurch.org. It should be on the screen. Grace and peace, everybody from Ohio.
Hi, Oasis.
Oasis.
We miss you.
Good morning, Oasis. Oasis. We love and miss you.
From my family to yours, grace and peace.
Good morning and grace and peace to everyone.
Hi, everybody.
We miss you guys. We're so excited to eventually get back to see everybody in person. And Ryan, say hi to Ander.
Hi, Ander.
Ryan, Mrs. Ander. Well, we love you guys. We all be safe, and we will see you all soon.
Bye.
Bye.
Good morning, Oasis. I hope you're feeling well. Grace and peace.
Hello, Oasis. Grace and peace. We miss you.
We can't wait to see you.
Hey everyone, we have a busy few weeks coming up and we want to make sure that you're aware of everything that's going on. Obviously, the big announcement is that we're going to be regathering for worship on Sunday, October the 4th in the Oasis building, and we'll have details on that in the weeks to come. This Saturday the 19th is Blessings and Hope Food Pantry's monthly distribution. This is an amazing opportunity to get groceries into the hands of families that are experiencing food insecurity, which is a real problem here in Polk County. There are volunteer opportunities from 8 a.m. until 2 p.m., and if you are available anytime within that window, your help would not only be greatly appreciated, but is also desperately needed. Be sure to click on the link in the video description below, and we will get you all the information you need to be a part of that event. Well, at the beginning of the year, we had talked about being a part of the Polk Ecumenical Action Council for Empowerment, also known as PEACE. This is a group of churches that have come together in Polk County and try to inform policymaking and law enforcement in ways that are equitable for all segments of our society, but particularly those that are usually under-resourced and underserved. The next step in our involvement in this organization is to have a series of listening sessions. These are going to be online meetings where we ask some questions and hear some stories and learn more about how we can be involved in this effort. There's a link in the video description below, and if you click on that, we would get you connected with one of these upcoming listening sessions as they're scheduled. We really hope that everyone who considers Oasis to be their home church will be involved in this in some way or fashion. Well, Saturday, September the 26th, we are proudly co-sponsoring the Polk Recovery Symposium. This is an event that's being put on by a group that's trying to start a recovery community here in Polk County. The idea is to connect people who are experiencing addiction with people who are in long-term recovery, getting them the tools and the resources that they need to be on the path to long-term recovery. If this is something you'd like to learn more about, this is a free event. It's online, and it's on Saturday the 26th from 10 a.m. until 2 p.m. There's a link in the video description below to a registration page where you can learn more about that. For more information about our youth ministry, OYM, be sure to check them out at Oasis Youth Ministry on Facebook and Instagram. And for more information about our children's ministry, Upstreet, be sure to check them out at Facebook Upstreet Kids Oasis. That's at Upstreet Kids Oasis. Well, now is the part of our service where we will worship by our tithes and our offerings. For those of you who have continued to support Oasis during our remote worshiping season, we're so grateful. And all of these events that we're having, all of these programs that we're putting on, this is all made possible through your generosity, and we are so grateful for it. If you're considering giving to Oasis today, I want you to know that there's four ways to give. You can send a check or a money order to the Oasis Building, which is located at 3330 Winter Lake Road, Lakeland, Florida, 33803. You can give online at oasischurch.org/give. You can give by texting any amount to 84321, and you'll be prompted with directions on how to complete that contribution. And you can also give via our Church Center app, which is also an amazing way to stay informed about everything that we have going on in our community. Let's pray. Today, Father, we thank you for your generosity that you provide for our every need. And we pray that you give us that same spirit of generosity, Lord, that we would give without fear. I pray that you bless everyone who gives today. And I pray that you bless the gift in its receiving, Lord, that we would use it wisely and effectively to serve your people and to advance your kingdom. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus. Amen.
Holy God, our image of you throughout history, we have been warped through faulty teaching and our tendency to make you fit into our image rather than acknowledge that we are made in your image. Help us, Lord, to recognize that Jesus is exactly who you are. May we worship you as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. May we, like Jesus, neither adopt the ways of the world nor pull ourselves out of the world. But may we love and serve our brothers and help us to bring your upside-down kingdom to earth. Merciful Messiah, our world needs a Savior. We ignore your message to love our neighbor and judge those who are different from us. We are selfish and greedy and have little to no compassion for the needs of others. We twist your words to support our political agendas and convince ourselves and others that an angry God is on our side as we kill and destroy our enemies. Forgive us, Lord, for the mess we have made of our world. Forgive us for manipulating religion to satisfy our desire for power. May we resist the greed and hunger for power of our earthly leaders and instead turn our face toward you, our true leader. Open our eyes and our ears so that we can see clearly any disconnect between what we say we believe and what our actions show we believe. May our love for you and our love for each other shape our actions, form our decisions, and allow your kingdom to reign in us and through us. And may we proclaim with one voice, we have no king but Jesus.
God of mercy and healing, you who hear the cries of those in need, receive these petitions of your people that all who are troubled may know peace, comfort, and courage. Bring healing to those in our community with ongoing illness. For Becca, Carrie, Emma, Lauren, Robin, and Jim, we ask for healing and relief of all sickness and pain. We pray for all the families navigating the new normal at school, as well as those participating in e-learning and school online. Foster patience, communication, grace, and understanding in every heart and mind. We pray for Carolyn, who is suffering with coronavirus. Ease her breathing and help her to recover quickly. We pray for Kristen, who lost her beloved father. May the presence of your Holy Spirit bring peace in their grief and be the abiding comforter that you have promised. Life-giving God, heal our lives that we may acknowledge your wonderful deeds and offer you thanks from generation to generation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Caiaphas Makes a Deal by Jody Burkett, read by Gretchen Suarez Pena.
How they had waited, constantly plotting, to remove that rabble-rouser from the streets. His uprising had led to bloodshedding. Now he was in a cell, his own blood clotting. From wounds he had received, death soon would be his reward. Another disappointing zealot, rotting. So, the leaders went on about their feast, their underhanded work done by Roman law, as the lamb was chosen for the Passover, and those same rulers devoured the beast. They began scheming to trap their next victim, that old would-be Messiah the people favored, treated like a king, turning them from the priest. Long had they sought to catch that pest, in word or deed, yet always he managed to hide, or to walk away from their upraised stones, having exposed the sins their own hearts caressed, leaving them in consternation over this and much more, forgiving sins as if he were God. Surely for blasphemy they could make an arrest. Now, in the confluence of time and place, during the Passover supper, the moment came. One of the rabbi's followers could be bought. He was willing to sell his master without a trace of remorse or guilt as the silver crossed his palm. At last, the trap had sprung. The Messiah king would no more be a threat to the Jewish race. "It is imperative to sacrifice one to save all," so the high priest had said, a grimace on his face. Now they had removed the rabble-rousing rabbi from before Caiaphas to deal with the Roman law. His beard plucked out, his back shedding blood. How little they knew they had sent the lamb to be slaughtered. The sacrifice, once for all. To their chagrin, Pilate offered a deal. The zealot murderer, or this taciturn king. One he would free during the feast, one condemn. He asked the people which sentence to repeal, and to his horror and disbelief, as one, they chose the militant man to be released into their midst, a man who was known to cause strife and to steal. The religious men shook upraised fists, unable to have both firebrands extinguished. Still, it was expedient that one man might die, not the whole race. So there hung Jesus by his wrists, the very Lamb of God who takes away all sins, the only one who could possibly save all men, priest and sacrifice, servant and king, very God he is.
Hello, everyone. Today we finish our series, Follow the Leader. We've been looking at various biblical characters and the way in which their leadership styles could be contrasted with Jesus. Our first week, we looked at Pharaoh and the way in which Pharaoh's way of being in the world in the Old Testament is contrasted with the prophets and then Jesus is identified with the prophets. The next week, we looked at Herod, King Herod the Great, who was the king of Israel when Jesus was born. Last week, Chris Green led us as we reflected on the contrast between Jesus and Pilate. And today, we're going to be looking at Caiaphas. He was the high priest during Jesus' adult ministry. He was the priest that kind of colluded with the Romans and negotiated the crucifixion of Jesus. Now, according to a lot of ways in which a priest's ministry might be measured, Caiaphas was quite successful. He was the high priest. So from the time of Hanukkah, when the temple had been rededicated to God, until the time that the Romans would come and destroy the temple, we have about 160 years. But there were a lot of high priests during that time. Their typical tenure only lasted about 3.5 years. But Caiaphas served as high priest for 18 years. And he had succeeded his father-in-law, Annas, so they kind of kept it all in the family. So Caiaphas was quite successful by a lot of measurements. However, Caiaphas kind of represents what I think is the most seductive of all of these leadership styles. Most of us will not find ourselves in these kind of super senior positions of leadership, like a Pharaoh or a Herod or a Pilate. We're not the governor of the state. We're probably not even the mayor of the city. We certainly aren't the president of the country. Those kind of senior leadership roles are so kind of far away from how we actually experience our lives that although I do think we mimic them more than we should, like we should be following Jesus and we follow these leadership things that are more coercive and manipulative. They use power to control as opposed to the way of Jesus that is in no way coercive and in no way manipulative. Jesus's power is the power of love and sacrifice. Jesus doesn't destroy, right? Jesus creates. And that is so different. Jesus's kingdom is so radically different than the way in which we structure our lives that it's almost unrecognizable, which is why I believe so many people that were following him had a hard time kind of reconciling their expectations about what a Messiah should be, and who Jesus actually was. And I might say, continues to be who Jesus actually is. So as we look at Caiaphas, it's a really tragic story. And again, he represents, I think, a very seductive power. Religion likes to kind of exert itself. And those who are religious, and particularly religious leaders, like to kind of come alongside the powers of the world and kind of use them for their own benefit to kind of shape the culture in such a way that is more godly, that is more pious. So Caiaphas, as he's kind of controlling the temple, and the temple is both a religious center and also a civic center, and He's doing those things that are kind of maintaining the status quo. But the status quo is kind of serving a certain system that is not inclusive of everyone. The status quo kind of is wrought with its own problems. And maintaining it is really not the way of Jesus. Jesus is offering us a fresh way, a new way of being in the world. Caiaphas is known as saying some really ironic and tragic things. Caiaphas says at one point during the trial of Jesus, he says, "It's better for one person to die than for all of us to kind of suffer and die." Now, what he's thinking at the time is he's seeing Jesus, who some people are saying is the Messiah, is the Son of God. And that's really kind of threatening him and making him angry. Caiaphas sees the Romans and he knows their power. And he realizes that if Jesus is allowed to lead kind of a revolt, a rebellion against Rome, that Rome is going to come and crush him. So in Caiaphas's mindset, it's better for Jesus to die as opposed to him be identified as the Messiah, lead a rebellion, and they all die. Which, of course, we know that Jesus's death is the very means through which all of us have access to life. Jesus himself is raised from the dead, and that is God's kind of eternal yes, right? No matter how bad things can get, even the very crucifixion of Jesus, God can take that and work something good, something great out of it. At one point, shortly after the Sanhedrin, the Jewish court, has kind of tried Jesus, Caiaphas kind of gets the ear of Pilate for a minute as the negotiations are going on to what to do with this man Jesus. And Caiaphas says this, he says it to Pilate. He says, "We, the Jewish people, we have no king but Caesar." Imagine that. The high priest of God's temple saying, "We have no king but Caesar." It's that kind of collusion with the worldly systems, with the powers that be. And I think this is the challenge. Like, when we say Jesus is Lord, it does imply that Caesar is not. At least when the early church said that. When they said Jesus is Lord, it implied that Caesar was not. To say that Jesus is the king is a threat to the Roman kind of rule of the land. But it's not the threat they think it is. Because when we say that Jesus is Lord, it doesn't mean that the rulers of this world, the presidents, the prime ministers, the emperors, the dictators, that Jesus is like them. Like, he's going to be the ruler. He's just stronger. He's just more powerful. It's not the king or the emperor, Caesar, who's on the throne. It's Jesus who's on the throne. And he's bigger and he's badder, right? He's more powerful. Jesus is an altogether different kind of leader. So Caiaphas was one way of being in the world, but Jesus certainly didn't follow that. But there were plenty of critiques of Caiaphas in the high priest system. It wasn't like all of the Jews were kind of enamored with Caiaphas. Particularly, there was one group of Jews who had kind of left the temple system. They thought that it was so corrupt that they couldn't continue to worship there. And they had moved out into the desert, and they were living there by the Dead Sea. We found one such community, archaeologists did, and it's called Qumran. And there we had for more than 100 years kind of a committed community who were reading the scriptures and really committed to personal purity and communal holiness, ritual kind of following of the law, of the Torah. Sometimes this community is associated with a group known as the Essenes. The Essenes seem to be one kind of extreme position. If Caiaphas is one extreme, kind of the religious leadership kind of colluding with the powers of the world, the Essenes are the other extreme. They are so detached from the world that they're just kind of maintaining their community until the deliverer comes. And I believe both of those extremes to be dysfunctional. A mentor of mine would say all extremes are dysfunctional. One of the Greek virtues is moderation. Christians have sometimes called it temperance. Our friend, Paul Harlan, one of the elders here at the church, I've heard him say often that he believes in moderation in all things, and that includes moderation. Like, we can't be extreme with our moderation. There are some things that we are so kind of wholeheartedly committed to. And those things are probably few and far between, but it's that I really want to focus on. I want us, as we close this series on Follow the Leader, not to focus on Pharaoh or Herod or Pilate or Caiaphas and not on those who would resist them, like the Essenes might have resisted Caiaphas, or the Pharisees might have resisted Herod and the Herodians. But what is the way of Jesus? What are those things that we can be kind of wholeheartedly committed to? There's two things I'd like us to do. I'd like to look at a gospel passage, and then I'd also like to look at a passage from Romans. So first, this gospel passage. Let's take a listen. This is the Gospel of Matthew.
Matthew 18, 21 through 35. Then Peter came and said to him, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves, who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart."
I really love Peter. He is so eager to kind of get things right. So he's been learning, I think, right? He's been learning from Jesus that Jesus's way is not one of coercion or manipulation. It's not the power that controls. Jesus kind of forgives. And so Peter kind of offers this hypothetical: if I get hurt, right, I should forgive seven times. Isn't that right? And Jesus is like, well, not just seven times, but if you get hurt in a day, you should forgive 70 times seven. See, in the ancient Near East, this conversation between Jesus and Peter is playing off an old tradition. So there was this idea that one way that you could prevent violence is the threat of more violence. So if someone killed one of your sheep, you might go and kill seven of theirs, and that might prevent them. That threat might prevent them from doing so. And so there wasn't a form of retribution where the crime would match the punishment. There was this kind of extreme action. But there's one particular fellow in Genesis. His name is Lamech. He kind of says, look, I am very strong, and my leadership style is the harshest. So if you come and take one of mine, I'm not going to take seven of yours. I'm going to take 70 of yours. So it's that kind of extreme violence, unlimited violence, that we see in the ancient Near East. So when years later, when Moses comes along and the law is given and it says an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, that sort of thing, that's not saying that's a minimum punishment that you have to do. Like if someone takes an eye, at least take their eye, maybe more, but you have to at least do that much. It's a maximum. It's saying that you can't have unlimited violence. It's limiting the violence. It's saying the most you can take for a tooth is a tooth. You don't have to, but that's the most you can take. The most you can take for an eye is an eye. So we move from this kind of unlimited violence to kind of limited violence. And then if you continue to read in the Torah, we get to this position of kind of limited love. Moses will say, love your neighbor. And in that context, your neighbor is your fellow Hebrew. But then the arc of this movement kind of culminates in Jesus. Well, Jesus will say, you have heard it said, love your neighbor. But I say to you, love your enemy. So we can see this movement from unlimited violence with Lamech. I'm just not going to kill. You kill one of mine. I'm not just killing seven. I'm killing 70. Then we get to this kind of limited violence, an eye for an eye and a tooth for tooth, to limited love, love your neighbor, to unlimited love, which is love your enemy. And so when Peter says, should I forgive seven times? He is, in a certain way, getting things very, very close to the right answer. He's realizing that that forgiveness, that Jesus's way, is the inverse of violence, right? Jesus's way of being in the world is the opposite of the way in which their culture would work. But Jesus is saying it's more than that. Like, we're not just going to love and forgive in kind of a limited way, matching Moses. We are going to love and forgive in an unlimited way, kind of matching in an inverse way, Lamech, which is exactly then how this story goes, the parable that follows in Matthew. The servant who owned 10,000 talents. I mean, that is just an enormous amount of money. That's more than any of them could have earned in like 100 lifetimes. It was just a debt that was way, way beyond the possibility of somebody paying back. And that servant is forgiven. And then in return, someone else kind of owns 100 talents, which is still a lot. But it's so, so much less than the 10,000 that the first fellow owed. And then he tries to exact that from someone else. And this is the way of Jesus. Jesus is teaching us that, look, our Father is the one who can forgive all the debts, like all that you owe, all of your transgressions, so that we need to become like that. We need to become forgivers. We need to become people of mercy. Like, our way of being in the world will not be coercive. It will not be manipulative. It will not use power to control. It will be a way of grace and mercy and forgiveness. Sometimes I hear people say, well, yes, God is holy, but God is also just. And they'll want somehow our systems to exact justice. But the important point to note, my friends, is that God's justice is never merely retributive. It's not just punishment that is paying back the punishment so that a punishment matches a crime. God's justice is restorative. It restores. That's what makes God God. That's what makes this good news such good news. You know, sometimes I hear the phrase, you know, love the sinner but hate the sin. And I get the sentiment behind it. And in some ways, I don't want to discourage it, but in other ways I do, because I think it kind of puts ourselves, when we say that, in a seat of judgment. And we're not the judge. Like, we don't have the capacity to do that well. In the end, Jesus, right? Jesus comes back to judge the world. That's Jesus's role. Our role is to be a witness. So maybe we could say, you know, love the sinner, but hate my own sin, right? I don't need much hate in my life. And if I just dislike the sin that I do, that's enough hate in my own life, just to hate kind of my own sin. And I'll leave the rest to God, right? I will be a forgiver. I will follow Jesus into this kind of unlimited love. It is a way in which we can be in the world and follow, I believe, our leader. I want us to move now to a passage in Romans. It's very practical about how we live with one another. Let's take a listen to this.
Romans 14, 1 through 12. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God.
You see, I think the Apostle Paul is kind of bringing this to a really kind of practical point. Again, our role is not the role of judge. Other people will find their way, right? How to kind of, for them, kind of work out their own salvation in fear and trembling, as another author of Scripture says. A way of being in the world that might not be exactly the way we would choose. So some are vegetarian, some eat meat. Some don't have the kind of scruples of the meat sacrificed to idols, others do. And we could probably find all sorts of things in our own context. Well, we might not agree exactly with others, but that's not the point. The point is that Jesus died for all of us, and that the fact that Jesus has died and has been raised again means that he is the Lord of the dead and of the living. And this is the way that we should be together. Paul was writing with a lot of kind of ethnic tension, right? A lot of kind of cultural differences. And certainly we can identify with that there's not a lot of equality and there's not a lot of justice that we see. And certainly I believe that we should be a people of justice and we should speak for it. But especially maybe in a political year, we need to find ways of kind of being in this world where we don't try and sit in judgment over our kind of fellow Christians. That there is a way that we can disagree on various issues, religious issues, social issues, political issues. But that doesn't mean that we can't have community. And that doesn't mean that we can't have kind of love and mercy and forgiveness with one another. Because I think that's what it means to follow the leader. Like, our leader is Jesus. And it doesn't mean that we can be Jesus. But we are, in some ways, the body of Christ, right? And as the body of Christ, we are to kind of live that life, kind of as his disciples. And I believe this is just that way. And I think the passage from Matthew about forgiveness, and I think this passage from Romans about how we kind of live with one another without judging one another, is a good way, a good start, kind of down that path of following the leader, Jesus Christ. So now I want us to come here in just a minute, but I want to end here. Thomas, one of Jesus's disciples, is known mostly, right, for being the doubter. But I think that's it's a bit of a misnomer. We all have our doubts, right? We don't want to be too harsh as we judge Thomas. We all have our doubts, and we all have times of faith. And there are times in the Gospels where Thomas really speaks up and says, hey, if Jesus is going to Jerusalem and they're going to kill him, then we should go with him. Like, it's better to die with our leader than to live alone. And that's a pretty big statement of faith. And maybe even more so, Thomas offers this very short prayer. It's when he sees the resurrected Jesus. Thomas falls down and he proclaims, my Lord and my God. Now, that's a prayer that I think we could adopt. Certainly today and this week, but really we could come back to it again and again. It's a very short prayer, but it says that by saying my Lord, I've often heard people say that too many people want Jesus as a savior, but not as a Lord. It's kind of a popular preacher thing to say. But there's a good point to be made there. We want to be rescued, but we don't want any kind of obligation. We want to be forgiven, but we don't want to have to forgive. We want to be shown mercy, but we don't want to have to be merciful people, kind of like the one servant in the parable from Matthew. But to say of Jesus, my Lord and my God, is to say something about our obedience, our commitment to Jesus as our Lord, and it's to say something about our worship, that Jesus is our God. So we might have other lords in our lives. Children have their parents, students have their teachers, teachers have their principals, you know, and on and on and on. But we only have one God. And our commitment to Jesus in this prayer of Thomas, my Lord and my God, I think is a great way for us to kind of wrap up this series on Follow the Leader. So that's my prayer today. My prayer is that I would be able to say of Jesus, my Lord and my God. And my hope for all of us is that you too might join me and Thomas in that prayer and pray, my Lord and my God. Thomas becomes a good example, I think, of what it means to follow the leader and not kind of go into those extremes of a Caiaphas or the Essenes, the religious compromisers or the kind of religious extremist. So that's our hope today. I love you all.
What will be left when I've drawn my last breath? Besides the folks I've met and the folks who know me, will I discover a soul-saving love, or just the dirt above and below me? I'm a doubting Thomas. I took a promise, though I do not feel safe. Sometimes I pray for a slap in the face, then I beg to be spared, 'cause I'm a coward. If there's a master of death, I bet he's holding his breath as I show the blind and tell the deaf about his power. I'm a doubting Thomas. can't keep my promises, 'cause I don't know what's safe. Oh, me of little faith. Can I be used to help others find truth? When I'm scared, I'll find proof that it's a lie. And can I be led down this trail, dropping breadcrumbs that prove I'm not ready to die? Please give me time to decipher the signs, and please forgive me for the time that I've wasted on the doubting Thomas. But I'll take your promise, though I know nothing is safe. Oh, me of little.
So we come to the table today, as we do every week. But as we come today, I want us to think that we are about following the leader. We follow Jesus to this table. It's his invitation. He's invited us. And the table represents peace. It represents forgiveness. It represents kind of overcoming the enmity that we might have had with God. And it also represents overcoming the enmity that we might have with one another. Table fellowship represents the fact that we've gotten over our conflict, that we've gotten past it. And we're able to do it because of Jesus. Like Jesus overcomes. And so that we follow Jesus and we too become overcomers. So as we say, this is the table, not of the church, but of the Lord. It is made ready for those who love him and those who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little. Come, you who have been here often and you who have not been here long. Come because it is the Lord who wants you to come. It is his will that we should meet him here. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we partake of the one loaf. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of God's word and spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, the Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to God. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take and eat together. Likewise, when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks to God, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's take and drink together. And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us, dear God, those of us who have gathered and who have partaken of these gifts of the bread and cup, as they represent for us the body and blood of Christ, May we be, for the world, the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Amen. Amen. I love you all. Can't wait to be with you. God bless you.
Hey everyone, thanks so much for joining us in worship today. Before you go, a few reminders. Blessings and Hope is this Saturday. We hope to see you there. The lobby is going to be open in a moment. That's where the service will end, but the video will continue to roll, and you're invited to join the conversation in the comment section below. If you haven't already done so, be sure to say hi. Let us know that you're here. And the prayer room is open. The prayer room is a Zoom meeting. There's a link in the video description below, and if you click on that, you'll be taken into a Zoom meeting with a member of the pastoral staff. We would love to pray with you. We're looking forward to October the 4th. Until then, we'll see you next week. God bless. Be safe. Take care.